More local corporate stories. DMCI Mining Corporation is on track to surpass its nickel ore production and shipments last year after recording notable improvements in the first semester. From January to June, its production nearly doubled from 567,000 wet metric tons to 1.12 million wet metric tons, which is already better than its 2022 full-year output. Meanwhile, shipments in the first half reached a little over 1 million wet metric tons, a figure that's equivalent to 73% of its total sales volume last year. Now, DMCI attributes this better output this year to improved operational efficiency and permit timing. Meanwhile, Globe Inc.'s term loan facilities with Metrobank for a total amount of 15 billion pesos. This to finance the telco giant's capital expenditures, debt refinancing, and other general corporate requirements. For real estate giant PhilInvest Plan, it filed a registration statement with the Securities and Exchange Commission to offer and sell peso-denominated fixed-rate bonds up to an aggregate principal amount of 35 billion pesos. The company also applied with the SEC the offer and issuance of up to 12 billion pesos fixed-rate bonds as the first tranche of its bond program, with an aggregate principal amount of up to 10 billion pesos. And finally, construction engineering company EEI Corporation approves the divestment of the firm's 60% interest, or a total of around 180,000 common shares of stocks, in its subsidiary Biotech JP Corporation. San Miguel Corporation asserts the business operations of its power unit remains viable and is continuously meeting its financial obligations. The Ramon Ang conglomerate responded to a warning by an international think tank for investors to tread cautiously on San Miguel Power Global Holdings due to its piling debts in contrast to its earnings. The company says SMGP remained profitable in last year, and it has been that way since it started operations in 2011. Now it revealed its consolidated revenues has reached 221 billion pesos, which are at par with results in prior years. Finally, it maintains the company and its subsidiaries are fully compliant with their financial obligations. Philippine bank lending growth eases in July. The credit growth of universal and commercial banks stood at 7.7% in the said month, down from last year's 12%. It's also a touch lower from the 7.8% in June. It is also the slowest since December 2021. Now, this dip comes amid the tight monetary policy of the central bank and as the pent-up local demand wanes. Here at home, the Philippine government's budget deficit in August reached 133 billion pesos as it saw revenues declining. That's higher than the 72 billion recorded a year ago and nearly triple the 47.8 billion pesos reported in July. Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno says this was due to the 6.6% contraction in the government receipts alongside a 10% growth in expenditures. As for the lower revenue collection in the said month, well, Diokno points to work suspensions due to bad weather. The Writers Guild of America reaches a tentative agreement with major studios that could see them go back to work. The three-year contract must still be approved by the Guild's leadership as well as union members before it can take effect. The 146-day strike has taken a heavy toll across the industry, with losses estimated in the billions. Writers walked off the job on May 2 after talks reached an impasse over several issues, including compensation, residuals, and the use of artificial intelligence. Now, once the new deal with the writers' union is signed, studios will next turn their focus towards getting striking actors back to work. The SAG-AFTRA, which represents 160,000 members, walked off the job in July. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are set for a cautious start to the week as traders wait for the release of the closely watched IFO Business Condition Survey from Germany, the region's biggest economy. European Central Bank Chief Christine Lagarde is also expected to speak later. Over in Wall Street, futures are pointing to a positive open. This as some bargain hunting is expected for the last week of September, with the major U.S. indices set for monthly losses. Asian markets open the final trading week of the quarter mixed after major central bank decisions. Traders are now looking ahead to the release of key economic data in the region. Out this week, inflation data from Singapore and Australia and consumer prices in the Japanese capital, Tokyo. Also weighing on investor sentiment, continued worries over China's embattled property sector. Over the weekend, China's Evergrande said it was unable to raise further debt, putting in peril its restructuring plan after defaulting in 2021. Now, looking at its share price, this Monday, the property developer is down by a significant 19%. Checking now on the major stock indices in the region, Hong Kong's Hang Seng is down by 1.5% on Chinese property sector concerns. The Nikkei 225, meanwhile, is on the green, along with Singaporean and the Australian markets.
Hydropower generation in Asia has sunk at the quickest rate in decades amid sharp declines in China and India. Energy think tank Ember said Asia's hydropower output fell 17.9% through July. This has forced power regulators battling volatile electricity demand and erratic weather to rely more on fossil fuels. The two countries, who account for about three-fourths of Asia's power generation, are also to a lesser extent using renewables to make up for the hydropower shortfall.